If you remember the 1970s and 80s, chances are you also remember the environmental crisis that dominated global headlines at that time. This is the story of its rapid rise, its spectacular fall, and the scientist behind it all.
My father was a school teacher and my mother was a homemaker, as they were called then. And I lived in a log cabin. And we were very poor, but we didn't know it because we had plenty of food to eat living on a farm and had a happy environment. So I grew up being very close to the land, being connected to the land from the very earliest memories that I have.
Though he grew up fascinated by nature, first, Likens wanted nothing more than to knock one out of the park.
I remember one, it was American Legion game. I struck out 12 batters. I walked 12 batters and lost the game.
Playing just 2 years in the Kansas Rookie Leagues, Likens decided there was more to life than baseball. After earning a PhD in zoology from the University of Wisconsin-Madison, Likens returned to his nature-loving roots and began researching ecosystems. To help with this, in 1963, the U.S. Forest Service granted Likens and his colleagues a playground of sorts on a site that would host the longest-running ecosystem study in history, a large swath of experimental forest in the White Mountains of New Hampshire containing the Hubbard Brook watershed.
A watershed is an area of land where water from rain or snow collects and drains into a common outlet. Here, rainwater falls onto the slopes of the Delaware Valley and drains into the river below. Complex ecosystems exist within the bounds of watersheds, and the water plays a very special role. It's these ecosystems that Likens and his team set out to study at Hubbard Brook. They analyzed waters flowing both into and out of the watershed. They found something quite unexpected.
So the very first sample of rain that we collected in July of 1963 was about 100 times more acidic than we thought it should be. 100 times.
Intrigued, Likens set up rain analysis stations in the most remote places on Earth. Among these were southern Chile, the tip of Africa, and an island in the middle of the Indian Ocean, accessible only by a month's-long journey by ship. The studies ran for 10 years and concluded that the rainwater at Hubbard was actually, in some cases, 1,000 times more acidic than rainwater in places unaffected by people.
Likens' theory went like this. Burgeoning industry across the Midwest released pollutants into the air, like sulfur dioxide. These gases would react with water vapor in the atmosphere to form strong acids, which could travel great distances before falling again as rain hundreds of miles from the source.
To test the theory, Likens boarded a small aircraft and literally chased plumes of factory emissions across the eastern U.S., taking samples by holding a collector out an open window. In the end, the evidence was clear. Burning fossil fuels had made acid rain a serious environmental problem in North America.
And my life has never been the same since.
Acid rain took the public by storm. The average person could see its damage without a microscope and a PhD. News reports pointed to cemetery headstones dated prior to and after the Industrial Revolution, showing the same extent of weathering. Art, buildings, bridges, our modern infrastructure bore the scars of acid rain. Its devastating effects extended to ecosystems, killing plant life and freshwater fish. The news traveled all the way to the top.
I was asked in the fall of 1983 to lead a small delegation to brief President Reagan and the full cabinet about the issue of acid rain. So we did that. We had a full hour. And I think it's the first time that certainly an environmental issue has been dealt with that way by the full cabinet and the president.
7 years later, Congress took action. The 1990 amendments to the Clean Air Act addressed the problem by sharply limiting the amount of sulfur dioxide allowed in emissions. The regulations vastly improved the outlook for the U.S. As for Likens, he's enjoyed an experience almost unheard of in the scientific community. His insight revealed a hidden crisis, and his direct advocacy helped bring sweeping change that made our world safer and healthier.
As I often say to students, I don't ever remember in my adult life waking up dreading going to work. I wake up looking forward to do my job because it's not work, it's what I love.